All right, welcome to Sports Scholars. I'm your host, Mike Mahoney. Got a lot of topics we got to cover today. Got a lot of information we got to throw your way. All right, in the back we got our good friends Nick, Greg, and Prakar somewhere. There
How's
he is.
How's it going?
Prakar is a new addition to the squad. He's probably going to be a special addition. He's not going to be around all the time. He's got to go to school or something.
Yes, but, he does.
No excuse.
You know.
No excuse.
No excuse to miss school, except for this show. But anyways, getting back on topic, we're going to be talking about the Big Four. We're going to be talking some Patriots. We're going to talk about some Boston Bruins, Boston Celtics, Boston Red Sox. You know, it's going to be Homer for life all day today. It's going to be the Homer episode. All right. But, you know, let's just kick it off. Let's kick it off with some Red Sox talk. You know, we all know that the Red Sox need pitchers. We know that they have a great offense. But, you know, for the pitching side, we don't have anybody. We have David Price, but David Price isn't playing as well as we'd hoped for. And other than that, we can't roll out David Price every game, so it's not really going that well. So, I mean, Greg, what do we got to do here, man? Like, who are we going to go for?
Well, I mean, at this point, you got to give up on some of these guys that aren't doing anything. You got people like Joe Kelly. See you later. Clay Buchholz, see you later. You got to start throwing some stuff at the wall and see what sticks. When you got something that you absolutely know isn't going to work, you got to try to go in a different direction. Even if it's not the greatest direction, you're not 100% confident, you have to know the way the roster is assembled right now. It's not a championship team, and that's the point. So you got to find something. I don't know. I worry about Eddie Rodriguez, too. I don't know about you.
I don't know. I mean, he had a good season last season. He doesn't seem to be getting off to the same start he had last time. I mean, we need pitching. That's what we need. And what we have is a lot of bats. So we talked about a lot of small names and we talked about a lot of packages we could get off last episode. But for this episode, I mean, let's talk about some big names. I mean, let's talk about some of the people we're going to grimace when we have to get rid of. What do you think, Greg? What do you think we got to go with?
Who do you think we're going to get rid of, or who do you think we're going to get?
Who would you, of all the big names, and I think we're in agreement on who that is, who do you think you would be most likely to let go of?
I'd like to see him go after Sonny Gray. I think that he's had kind of an off year, but he's a good player, and I think that maybe he just needs a change of scenery. Sometimes you get someone like that, and they're just in a funk, but they're a good player, and if you can steal him at the absolute lowest point of his value, that's what you got to do. What do you think, Michael?
I don't know. Oh, but what I was trying to say was, like, who on the Red Sox, of all the bats and of the offense.
I zoned out for a second. I'm sorry.
Would you be – no, that's cool. I mean, we got to talk about prospects on that side too. But, I mean, of the bats, like, of all the good bats, of all the good players that have established themselves, who would you be willing to trade or package?
Jackie Bradley Jr.
Even if it
probably
hurts
not
you.
A popular opinion, but I think that he's at the absolute height of his value. You're never going to get – you're never going to get more for Jackie Bradley Jr. than you're going to get right now. This guy's been a weak hitter all through the minors up until this year, and all of a sudden he rolls off a 29-game hitting streak, and we're talking about him like a middle-of-the-order bat. It's a fluke. Trade him in the middle of it. Try to get something big for him. If you can't keep him, he's not a bad player. He's a great defensive guy. But you know what? If some team really buys the hype on this guy and you can get a starting, you know, a frontline starting pitcher for him and a couple of guys, I think that's the kind of move you make.
I got to agree with you.
It's very unpopular, though.
I love JBJ. I really do. But, I mean, we just have an embarrassment of riches. We don't want to get rid of Mookie Betts. We don't want to get rid of Xander Bogaerts. I mean, you know, other than the prospects, I mean, JBJ would be the next one up to probably have to package him to get a very good pitcher.
Yeah, and the other guy we were talking about last week, too, is Blake Swihart.
Oh, yeah.
I know he's hurt right now, but still, when he comes back, if he can put the bat on the ball a little bit, he's the kind of guy, he's very redundant. I like Christian Vasquez more as a long-term answer at the catcher position.
He's a better defensive catcher.
I'd move him, too. I'd move him and JBJ, see what you can get.
I don't know. I think it's just a rough situation for the Red Sox. I mean, whatever they want to go for, they need some depth in the rotation. They also need a number two. Some would say they need a number one. So it's a very tough situation that they've put themselves in, but, you know, hopefully they figure it out. Maybe they'll get a name like Cole Hamels. He's been thrown around. You're going to have to pay a lot to get him, though.
A lot.
To be fair, though, it's a tough position, but they are still tied for first place. So it's a better position than they've been in the last few years.
That will not last.
Yeah. It might not, but I just remember them being in last place the last few years, and I'll take it. It's a tough spot, but at least they're a piece or two away and not five pieces away like they have been in the past. So some credit to the Red Sox for putting together at least a respectable roster, but they do need to take another step if they want to be a serious contender.
And I'm going to have to rescind that compliment you just gave them, because they didn't do it through – they did some of it through free agency, but they are also the reason why we have to pay Pablo Sandoval and Hanley Ramirez those ridiculous contracts. And most of the prospects are the ones that are rising up and giving the Red Sox the boost they need to win this game. So it's all coming through the system. So honestly, through free agency, we haven't really had that much luck. So I'm not
I do think, though, that Pablo Sandoval's available at some point, that we could pick him up for the sports scholars. I mean, the guy could eat the pizza. He could eat the full pizza.
Oh, we could eat two, three pizzas.
He could
pizzas.
Probably eat two. Two to five pizzas that guy could probably eat in one sitting.
That'd be a good segment.
Greg, he'll make you look silly. You're only eating five slices.
It would make me look silly, but you know what? I got to give the guy respect. He might not be a good baseball player, but he can eat pizza.
Yeah, he probably can, you know. Hopefully he's recovering from that terrible injury, and we hope to see him back soon.
Then I hope that he actually comes back and does something. You know, on some level, you feel bad for the guy. He was a great player, but who knows what happened.
Yeah, his ego and his stomach enveloped and bloated him out. But anyways,
he won
too
many sports scholars.
Come to the sports scholars, though. We would love you, Pablo Sandoval. Anyways, moving on, we got the Celtics. We got to talk some Celtics. They got a lot of picks, you know. They got a lot of prospects they got to pick up. They got a lot of cap space. And, you know, apparently Kevin Durant sent them a list of free agents they got to sign. I'm not sure how likely it is for Kevin Durant to be coming
here. I'll answer that question. Sorry, before you go any further, it's not likely. Kevin Durant is not coming to Boston.
All right. I like to hold out a little bit of hope because there's a chance. There's always a chance.
I
you never know.
I appreciate the optimism.
But
okay,
anyways,
Lloyd.
It's time to talk about another player. Another player who's in the NBA Finals right now who is being blamed and scapegoated for the woes of the Cavs right now, and we're talking about Kevin Love, a name that we really wanted last year, but we were unable to get because LeBron James wanted him on his team. Now LeBron James doesn't want him on his team, and I kind of think that Kevin Love's going to be leaving Cleveland after the playoffs. So, I mean, what do you guys think? Would you take Kevin Love?
Yes, emphatically, I would take Kevin Love. The problem with the Celtics is they have a lot of good things in place structurally. They have a good GM, a good coach, a good system. They don't have a lot of talent. It's a talent problem. And Kevin Love's a talented player. And I'd be very willing to take him on. He's a good passer. I think he'd fit in on this team. He's a very, very rich man's Kelly Olynyk, a stretch four. And I really think that he would make a giant difference on a team like this. You know,
huge.
LeBron is just such a selfish player. And same with Kyrie. He's in a bad situation. And I'd be willing to take a little bit of a reclamation project and take on Kevin Love. I would be very happy to see him, and maybe his uncle could get the Beach Boys to play.
Yeah.
As his uncle is a Beach Boy.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Wouldn't it be nice?
It's a bonus.
Yeah.
That was a good joke. Yeah. That was a very
like
good
the
joke.
Reference?
I like
you
it.
Catch
no,
it.
You were plotting your own joke.
My friend.
Hold on. Mike, I got to give credit where it's due really quick, and I think you probably know what's coming. Turn up the volume on the Pempa, please.
Thank you.
Joke of the day.
Joke of the day. You know? It's all serious business on the Sports Scholars,
dancing
but when it comes
Fenway,
to us, it
dancing
comes to
Fenway.
Us.
Dancing
all right. I said to give you some credit, Mike, but go ahead.
Going back.
All right. That was great. But anyways, talking about Kevin Love, a lot of fans might be a little iffy on the whole trade because, you know, he hasn't been playing as well as he did on the Timberwolves. But the thing they have to realize is the Timberwolves put him in the right position to be a productive member of the team. The Cavs have not. They've put him on the outside. They've put him to shoot threes all the time when he's supposed to, you know, be going in the paint. He's supposed to be scoring points down there, but you don't want to do that because that's LeBron's territory. So I think if, you know, with Brad Stevens, Kevin Love would be able to be the star player that he needs to be. He would be in a good system. Brad Stevens would know how to use him. We need a bigger guy. And, you know, Kevin Love, I don't even know what his height is, but, I mean,
he's 6'10", I thought.
He's a legitimate big man. And I think
he's not just tall, he's
wide.
He'd
fit in perfectly, too. He's a great passer. And that's what you want on a team like this, where you have a lot of guys who can shoot, kind of, you know, but don't have a really elite player who can make create his own shot. You need guys who can move the ball and make opportunities for other players. I think he'd be a perfect fit in this team. I really hope they get him.
Yeah.
Because they're not getting Kevin Durant. They're not getting Kevin Durant.
All right. Well, they have two, they have room for two max contracts. So if one of them goes to Kevin Love, which is probably what we're going to have to do, the other one, not Kevin Durant, we're going to say Kevin Durant's off the table. Who would you go for?
I'd try to get Jimmy Butler.
Yeah, so I was going to say the same thing.
Jimmy Butler. I think if you roll out a big three of Isaiah Thomas, Jimmy Butler, and Kevin Love, they all complement each other. I think that's a good trio. The other max guy that I like, not love, is Al Horford. But if you're going after Horford, I don't think you're going to go after Love. Those two guys, I just can't. Mm. I mean, maybe you could stick Horford at center, but I think a better combination would be Butler, Love, and Butler, Isaiah.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think, Mike?
The team would be pretty big if we get, like, an Al Horford or DeMarcus Cousins.
I never liked DeMarcus Cousins.
Oh, if we got Boogie Cousins, I take everything back. I forgot about him as a possibility because I kind of don't think it'll happen. But if we get him, I'd take him over anyone.
Yeah, Kevin Durant's off the table right now because you guys are non-believers.
Yeah, I'd go Boogie Love and Isaiah.
Yeah.
It sounds like a great band name. Boogie Love and Isaiah.
Boogie Love and Isaiah, like Hootie and the Blowfish.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That'd be a great team. And honestly, even with Kevin, I feel like with Kevin Love alone, we would make it past the Atlanta Hawks, and then we'd probably be in the Eastern Conference Finals. I really believe that because, I mean, that's how bad the – I mean, no offense, but that's how bad the Eastern Conference
is. Oh, the East is terrible. And you got to think you'd also be taking them off the Cavs, and who knows who would replace them. So maybe you could make a run against Cleveland if they lost Kevin Love and you picked them up.
And then you probably lose to the West because
that's
the West is unbeatable.
Maybe
everyone
in
the West tears their ACL. Same game. We have a shot.
How many do you want, like 100 ACL tears in a season?
I don't want them, but that might be the only way to win. You know?
I know. We're not going to the NBA Finals next year.
No.
We're not going to win the NBA Finals in like 2 years. It's going to be a slow build. That's how most teams go. But we'll be a very good team if we get Kevin Love. We'll be an even better team with Kevin Love, and we'll be an even better team if we get another contract with maybe like a DeMarcus Cousins or Jimmy Butler.
We have room for what, two, you said? Two max?
Two max, yeah.
I think we have room for two max. We're going to be drafting a lot of players if we can't get rid of those trades.
We have, 8 picks, I want to say, in this draft?
We have more picks than we have spots on our roster.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
So what do you do with that? Do you package? Or you just draft
the other people
options overseas?
You stash guys overseas. Yeah. I think they do that and they package and just push stuff into the future. I mean, they might take a little hit, but the thing you got to remember with the NBA is a second round draft pick isn't really worth all that
nothing.
Much. You know, there's not been a lot of great players coming out of the second round. I know in Celtics history,
Isaiah Thomas did
pull off Glenn Big Baby Davis as a second round pick, as was Leon Poe, the famous Leon Poe from the Leon Poe game.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the kind of guys you can get, complimentary guys.
Bench players, like
guys on a championship team, you need, but you're not gonna grab Gilbert Arenas. That was a once in a lifetime deal.
No, Isaiah Thomas was the last pick. He was the 60th pick.
Hmm.
Right,
I did not know that.
Could have sworn.
I mean, there has been a little revitalization in the second round, though. That like names like DeAndre Jordan, they had Draymond Green. I mean. It's getting more attractive to just get picks, you know, just to see who works, who doesn't, because you don't know who's going to show up and who's not.
Yeah, that's a valid point. It certainly doesn't hurt, but then you're almost assuming that you're going to cut some of these guys. So it's a strange position to be in.
Well,
you
got
to spend a lot of lottery
tickets.
Danny
Ainge is going to have some fun.
You got to spin it. That's what you got to do.
You better have some fun with this one.
And we still have two first-round picks from Brooklyn. Still.
Yeah, and I wouldn't...
Not this draft, the next two drafts.
We have two more, right?
We have two more.
And one of the things to think about with those is, as bad as Brooklyn is, they're not getting any better because we've had their first-round pick for so long. The team is just getting worse and worse and worse and worse.
Which is awesome.
So there's a legitimate chance that Danny could turn
Ainge
into
gets
a franchise player.
Danny Ainge should get an extra giant paycheck for that. It was one of the best
trades. He did. It's got re-signed.
Yes, he did.
Beautiful.
Even bigger. Sign him at 10. Sign him twice.
Beautiful. And we're talking about signing people, so I'm going to have to switch gears to the Patriots right now.
Smart.
Right now, there's a lot of contracts talked. A lot of people are saying that since Gronk hasn't come to the mandatory minicamp, he's thinking about holding out, trying to get the big money. And I got to say, you got to pay the guy. I mean, he knows how much he's worth, not only as a tight end, but as a receiver. And, you know, just that type of build and that type of athleticism and just raw power, you got to pay the guy. You can't joke around. Tom Brady is getting older and older, and the best way to help out a young quarterback is by giving him good receivers. And if you give him a giant tight end like Rob Gronkowski, who's pretty much the best tight end in the entire game, you got to pay him, you know?
And I agree wholeheartedly.
I agree.
And just to build on that too, one of the things about Gronk is he's quite possibly the greatest tight end of all time.
Yes.
So
there's a chance to be, yeah.
That's not, no, overall, he can block. I mean, can block. There's too. No one who
does Jimmy Graham
everything.
Who can block.
I just think that when you have a guy like that, you got to pay him. You break the bank for guys like him. You break the bank for guys like Brady. You don't necessarily break the bank for some of these middle-of-the-road guys that over the years they've shown the willingness to let walk. You know, they've let guys who are middle-of-the-road or even upper middle-of-the-road kind of guys go. And there's always the hoopla, you know, why would you trade Logan Mankins to save salary? Why would you trade Laura Malloy? Pro Bowl kind of players, but they're not all-time
greats. Who won you
greats.
A Super Bowl, too?
They're not all-time greats, and that's the kind of guys that you got to extend for. But just, Mike, in terms of priorities, if you had to prioritize all these guys coming up for contracts, so you got Gronk, you got
Collins,
Dante Hightower, Jamie Collins, and Malcolm Butler. What order would you put them in for importance?
For importance?
Mm-hmm.
I know who's number one.
Well, Gronk, I think we
Gronk
can all...
is, I think, a unanimous
yeah,
number one.
Gronk's number one because looking to the future and even looking for those four games, I mean, Jimmy Garoppolo is going to need all the help he can get, and if Gronk's not there, it's going to be a severely different game.
Yes.
It's even a severely different game for Tom Brady when Gronk's not there. You
yeah,
know,
points
I mean, he's
per
just
game
that,
and stuff like that.
He's a big game changer. He can block. He can run through people. If you give him open space, I mean, there's few people who can take him down.
What else does Gronk do? He drags how many defenders to him, so you got single coverage on people like Edelman.
Absolutely. It just changes the game plan across the board.
You put the safety help goes to Gronk, and then who do you have? You got single coverage on Amendola and Edelman, and who gets open the quickest? And they both kind of get open pretty quick, and that's how they move down the field.
I mean, you know, and he's going to get a lot more help with Martellus Bennett.
All right, but after Gronk, I think we can all agree on Gronk.
Gronk,
number two.
After Gronk, number two, the way the league's trending, I have to say Malcolm Butler. Mm. Malcolm Butler is important. I mean, the other two linebackers, I mean, they're very athletic, they're very good, and they're going to help out a lot. But the running game is nothing like it used to be.
Nope.
And you need to be able to cover the receivers, and you need to be able to cover them without – you know, drawing a flag, and that's really important. And Malcolm Butler has been doing a really good job with that. He's been holding his own against Antonio Brown, who's a freak of nature as an athlete.
Odell Beckham, too.
He got into Odell Beckham's head, which everyone knows now that all you have to do is piss him off and he's good. But anyways, like, I mean, you gotta be able to cover those guys. And then after Malcolm Butler, I would say Jamie Collins, because I think he's a better athlete than Dante Hightower, and then Dante Hightower would be at the bottom of that. I mean, Jamie Collins just he showed a lot of just pure strength. I mean, when he leaped over, like
an extra point, right?
Oh, it was a great play.
Extra
yeah.
point. He cleared him. Like, if he touched any of the other guys, they would have thrown a flag
that's
on
a
it.
Flag.
But he cleared them. He cleared other people who were jump
Chancellor,
up. And these are
Cam
pretty
Chancellor
good guys.
Did that twice.
Oh yeah.
Well, I mean, we don't have Cam Chancellor.
I know, and he did it twice in back-to-back plays, and he still did it. Like, it's these people are
it's
freaks
freakish.
Of nature.
Yeah,
well,
but I mean, like, Cam Chancellor's a really good player.
Yeah, but he held out.
Jamie Collins is also a very good player, and I think Jamie Collins has more power, and I feel like he's more of a.
I would have swapped Malcolm Butler and Jamie Collins. Hightower's definitely fourth. I would have swapped them.
See, I thought about that too, but I'm going to go ahead and agree with Mike. I think that Collins I'd consider. It is a passing league, and I would do the same order. So I would say Gronk, Butler, Collins
Hightower.
As much as I love Hightower. Just because the Butler takes away the best weapon on the other team, and then Jamie Collins is a great versatile player too because he can cover the tight end position. He can rush the passer, but he's really great in the passing game.
The running back out of the backfield, he can cover him too.
Yeah, I like the versatility that those two guys give him. So I'm with you, Mike.
Yeah, I mean, also I think it might be easier to calm down Malcolm Butler with a contract. I don't think you have to, like, I think Greg touched on it, and I didn't agree with it at the time, but thinking about it more, like, he doesn't seem the type who would just get upset because he's getting paid like $600,000 right now.
He's getting paid like chump change.
So if you just give him a medium journeyman's cornerback contract,
like 3 or 4 mil,
you know,
he'll, yeah, absolutely,
he'll be like, all right, sure, totally.
Yeah,
like,
why not? Why I wouldn't you take that security?
You know, that's
take
a,
it
that's,
for a couple
that's
years,
still
build
a lot of
it
money.
Up, and then if you're really good after that, then you can get a really good, like, I wouldn't say Revis caliber, but a step below that.
Yeah, Revis just knows how to work the game. He knows how to.
He's willing to hold out.
Yep.
He doesn't care about anybody but Revis. And, you know, I mean, that's not a bad thing, really.
That being said, thank you, Darrell, for the Super Bowl.
Yes,
thanks,
I
bud.
Was going to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
and
you.
Also, thank you for sucking after that. I'm glad
yes.
we didn't
yep.
pick up
very
your
much
option.
Appreciated.
You made
very
us look better
thank
than
you
that.
Thank you for just sticking it right to the Jets. It's beautiful.
You know, you're a good
you
person.
Know, bless your soul.
We should put him in the Hall of Fame. We really should. Just for that. Just for that one Super Bowl and what he did
Super
to the
Bowl
Jets.
And then what he did to the Jets. You go in the Pats Hall of Fame. Honored
easy.
At halftime.
Easy. I mean, there's a lot of Hall of Famers who haven't even won us. Is there? No.
Yeah, John Hanna never won one.
John Hanna was a freak. John Hanna, he played in like the 50s, didn't he?
Say, 60s.
No, later than that.
60s, 70s, I want to say.
60s, 70s?
Yeah.
The league
he
was
doesn't
different
have
then.
One.
No, he's,
Terry,
in the, he's in the actual
Did Terry
Hall of
Glenn
Fame
win
too.
One?
Who?
Terry Glenn?
Nope.
No.
I didn't think he won one either.
The
he's
Patriots didn't win any
until
championships
01.
Until 2001.
The 2001-2002 season.
Yeah, that's when we started winning championships. I'm
that's
not
when,
even sure if they
we
won any AFL
good.
Championships. I don't think they did.
No.
I said, I could have sworn Terry Glenn was gone
nope.
before then.
Oh, yeah, he was.
Oh, yeah. But anyways.
So, Mike, what else have we got?
What else have we got? We got to talk about our less bright spot in Boston sports.
The
we got to talk about the Bruins.
Oof.
Yeah.
Yeah, oof.
And it's all about philosophy. I mean, I was reading an article on Bleacher Report about how the Bruins are trying to be the big bad Bruins, and the game's getting too fast for them, you know. And I'm like, you know, that makes sense. We have a lot of old people. We have a lot of, you know, Zdeno Chara is not nearly what he used to be.
Not even close.
I mean, you know, it's just we're not the big bad Bruins anymore. We got rid of Lucic. We got rid of Boychuk. We got rid of Hamilton. You know, we don't have those big bodies throwing around, you know, beating the crap out of players. We just, you know, we don't have the people, and the way the game is going, that's not a very viable option. Now, Claude Julien, I mean, you can make the argument that he's being handed talent that cannot win games, but you could also
hear that argument very shortly.
You could also make the argument that his philosophy is outdated, and no matter how good of a coach he is, if he's not willing to change his philosophy, then the Bruins aren't going to be improving anytime soon.
Nope, they're going
to be downhill. All right, can I correct you on this one?
You can try.
So I don't think it's a philosophical issue at all. I think it's a talent issue. I think that the way that the Bruins win is to do what the Bruins do.
Wear people down.
And be the big bad Bruins. You're not going to out-finesse Sidney Crosby and the Pittsburgh Penguins. You're not going to play against Washington and beat them in Washington's game. You're not going to beat the Blackhawks playing the Blackhawks game. The way they won when they won in 2011 is they went up against some of these teams and they knocked them around. I mean, look at Vancouver in the finals. Vancouver was a great team. President's Cup trophy winning team.
They could score. They could defend.
But they had puck-moving defensemen, but they weren't big, and they got pushed around over the course of a seven-game series, and that's how we edged them out. I think that that's what you got to do. You got to embrace that philosophy, build from the blue line out, and the net, the blue line, and then forward. And two-way forwards like someone like Patrice Bergeron is a perfect fit for this team. The problem is right now they're trying to do this and they're relying on Seidenberg, Chara,
Kevin Miller.
What's his name? Adam McQuaid.
Yeah. Louis Erickson.
Louis Erickson just doesn't fit at all. Louis Erickson.
Sure, he can score goals, but
he's not even talk about Louis Erickson.
He's too afraid because he has how many? What, 3 or 4 concussions? So if he gets one more, it's 5.
He doesn't fit in at all. But he'll be gone hopefully. But the thing is, you need those cornerstone defensive players, and they're not regenerating them.
They need Shattenkirk.
If they were to get those kind of guys, I think that they could win. I think they could win championship with that style. With Claude Julien as a coach, the problem is they can't get those guys. Last year, they tried to trade up in the draft to grab Noah Hanifin, big defenseman who would have anchored the entire defense, and they couldn't get it done. So I think
that
if they were able to do something like that, that is the kind of team that could win a championship. What are you going to do? Have Patrice Bergeron try to out Patrick Kane?
No, that'll never happen.
Is that your plan, Mike?
You get
on the spot. Is that your plan? Come on.
You get more speed, all right? You're half right. They need to be the Bruins. They need to be able to hit, but they need to be faster, okay?
They traded it away.
I'm sorry?
They traded it away.
They traded their defense away.
They traded and they traded Sagan away.
I mean, you got to admit.
For a nobody.
You got to admit, Greg, they traded away Julian's big bad Bruins.
Oh, absolutely. So that to me means the problem isn't Julian.
But you don't think Julian had any say in any of those matters?
No, it's not even Sweeney. It was Chiarelli.
Peter Chiarelli and Don Sweeney are the problem. If you give Cole Julian a good roster, he's the best coach the Bruins have ever had, he'll be able to win games. You can't blame the guy. I mean, I was sitting at home in November. It was a Saturday night, and they called me and asked me to play defense. That's how desperate they were.
That was bad.
Oh, my God.
It's not Julian's fault.
And Greg, he was injured, too, probably, at the time.
Oh, I usually am.
See, he probably had a broken nose and an ACL tear, and he still could have played better defense.
Yeah, but you need to reinvigorate this team. These players are not playing with heart, all right? None of them are. I mean, I want to get rid of all these players just as much as you do, but there has to be a point where they've come very close to becoming into the playoffs, and they haven't gotten there. And
by
that's
one
not all
point
the, that's not
the
all the players'
year,
fault.
Nope, and the regulation overtime wins this year. It's one win. It's one little win.
But that's just to make it. It's not to do anything.
Even if you make the playoffs, it's better than sitting at home doing nothing.
Not much.
You know. Well, yeah, but I mean,
I get to watch it.
I mean, we're talking about the Celtics, and the Celtics probably aren't going to win a championship for a while. You know? I mean, we're talking about the Red Sox.
Well, what's a while for the Celtics? Like 5 years?
Depends on who they get.
All right. I wasn't going to get on you with this one. We're going to disagree with the Celtics, too. Because if you remember, the last time the Celtics won the championship, the year before, they had an 18-game losing streak. Things change really quickly in the NBA. You package these deals together. You pick up a big three. You tend to do it quickly. Look at Cleveland. They were horrible. They got three number one picks in a row.
Yeah.
They go LeBron James, Kevin Love, and Kyrie Irving all of a sudden on the same team, and they're in the finals. It happens quick.
Yeah, but LeBron James decided to go to Cleveland. And
Kevin Durant is not coming
chip.
To Boston. So you're
Nobody
right.
wants to come to Boston. That's the word on the street. Like, oh, why would I want to come to Boston? We don't have a Paul Pierce-type player. We have Isaiah Thomas, which is all well and fine, but we don't have a Paul Pierce-type player. And I don't think even Kevin Love would fill that void. But, I mean, anyways, back to the Bruins. I think that they need to change their philosophy.
Never.
They need to make more of a hybrid big bad Bruins with speed and might.
You want like fast and furious type of thing?
You know, I mean, they gotta get a new goalie.
We should draft like Dominic
Toretto.
Well,
I think they should do one thing really well. They should pick a path. They shouldn't try to be fast and tough. They should either be the toughest team or the fastest team. And I think the only one that's reasonable, given the makeup of the league and how hard it is to get a legitimate superstar scorer, would be to embrace what they have. I think they have a good goalie, and they have Bergeron, are the two things they're building around, and who's a great two-way player, one of the best defensive players in the league from a center position. And you build around that, and I think that is the path.
That's what they're doing, because Marchand's his contract's up at the end of this year.
They're trying to extend him.
They're trying to, but... They should. If Don Sweeney doesn't, he's an idiot.
If he does, he's an idiot too. He's just an idiot.
Yeah, Brad Marchand. Yeah,
given what Claude Julien has, you know, for talent, you know, that team should not have had 90 something points. Like, I'll give him credit for that. That he took a team with.
So Mike, who do you dump this offseason?
On the Bruins.
For what, the Bruins?
Bruins, yeah.
Who do I dump?
I would have said Kevin Miller.
Mike.
Who wants it? Who wants anything on our team? Louis Erickson, get rid of him. I don't need him. Sedano Chara, try to trade him. Get something for him. Trick
He's
another
got
an team.
NTC.
Huh?
No trade clause. No trade clause for Big Z. Same thing with Seidenberg.
Don't pay Kevin Miller $5 million.
$10 million.
$10 million?
Yeah, two and a half over 4 years.
Stop being dumb, all
it's
right?
A waste of money.
Get rid of Don Sweeney. Just get rid of them altogether. I really could care less about the guy. Try to get a new invigorating coach with a new philosophy to, you know, kick these guys into gear.
Who?
Doesn't matter who at some point, you know. It's, I don't know every
sometimes
NHL.
Sometimes new is just the way to do it.
Yeah, exactly.
Something new.
Like Bobby Valentine in there.
No.
I think it's something to watch. I do agree with you, Mike, that there needs to be some substantial change. They can't tread water. They need to make some impact moves and find ways to get new guys in here that maybe will respond to Claude, and they're going to have to be kind of bold. I absolutely agree. It's just for me, I would rather them see them try to get guys that fit the old Bruins mentality than to switch their philosophy entirely. But I agree, if they come into next year just doing these little moves and expect not to be more of the exact same, just have a mediocre team, they're gonna be in trouble.
Yeah, the thing that freaks me out is the way the Bleacher Report article was written and the way Don Sweeney responded to the questions. Like, it was like, oh, we're gonna fill out the best option, we're gonna figure out the best way to, you know, put the team together. And that just felt like, to me, like he's getting ready to excuse some dumb moves that the fans and like everyone else doesn't want, but the Bruins for some reason think is a good idea. And that's why I don't think the Bruins aren't going to be very good for a while. I mean, it's going to be a while before they get back into the playoffs. I mean, they were supposed to be in the playoffs the last 2 years and they weren't in it. So, I mean, not looking good if you're a Bruins fan.
Agreed.
Any conclusions?
And the other part too is just that this will be my last take on this, is the point isn't to get to the playoffs. The point is to win. And if you have to be bad for a few years in order to win and to rebuild your team, it's better than being mediocre and treading water for years and years and years and years and years. You're better off really being bold and trying to make some moves than just saying, okay, maybe we'll get one playoff series and pad the Jacobs pockets for 1 year. It's just not the point. For me.
All right. Well, Greg, you are in a minority, because most people who think they go into the playoffs they have a chance to win the cup. And that's the bad part.
Every team in the playoffs has a chance. Look at the Kings when they won their first one. They were the 8 seed and they beat the 1 seed, then the 2 seed, then the 3 seed.
They were a talented team though, and they had some injuries. They shouldn't have been an 8 seed.
No, they shouldn't have. But still, like, they were hot going in the playoffs.
Yeah,
you'd rather, like, the hot team going in the playoffs, usually the one that goes far, not the best team. It's the team that has the hot goalie or, like, the scorer who just, you know, happens to find his game at, you know, game 60 and plays 50, like, you know, 22 unbelievable games and goes into the playoffs. That's what you have to find. And
I'd rather
the Bruins
have
one of those people.
I'd rather have a good team, but that's me. I don't know, but conclusions to the show. What do you guys got? You guys got any predictions? Any final notes you want to throw in there?
Really, I think the big thing is this is sort of a weird part of the sports here. You know, maybe by the time we're back, NBA and NHL could be over, and
probably
Patriots minicamp has just started up. And I think the Patriots stuff's really going to start ramping up. The NFL, things are going to be working. You're going to start to hear some word about how Jimmy Garoppolo's doing. And I'm pretty excited. I'm pretty excited to get into football talk. That's easily my favorite thing to talk about besides soccer. But, you know, thanks,
Boo.
Mike.
Well, you know,
we'll see how many times fans kill off Roger Goodell.
It's not the World Cup, Greg. We can't just talk about soccer.
Copa Americana. You know.
Copa Americana. Yeah. I mean, we could talk about the soccer playoffs. I mean...
Oh, wait. There aren't any.
There isn't any.
Copa Americana, you know.
No, how many times do you think Roger Goodell is going to get killed before next week?
They already killed him off on Twitter.
They killed him off on Wikipedia. How many more do you think?
What is dead may never die.
It rises again.
He keeps
stronger.
Rising. Good God.
Roger Goodell.
Mike, thank you for quoting the Ironborn.
Of course.
Thank you. Nice.
That gets you another Pampa.
I'm raking them in. Ever since Brian got out of here, I'm raking them in.
All right, Mike, any last words before we sign off?
Any last words? All right, let's go down the list. I want Prakar to say something because he hasn't said anything. Prakar, you got to get me some predictions, some sports predictions.
Who, me?
Yeah. Any new shows coming up on Bedford Public TV you want to talk about?
Don't look at Greg.
You're on the spot.
On the spot.
Think quick.
I'm a terrible person.
Shows
you know
that are
going to
be on Bedford TV?
We're running out of drive space, so hurry up.
What's your connection prediction?
Oh, yeah. Who's going to show up? Ken, Zach, Julian? Any combination? What do you think?
Should be Ken.
Well, Ken is obvious. Are Zach and Julian going to show up?
Probably Zach.
All right.
Most likely Zach.
All right, you heard it here first.
Just Ken and Zach on Friday.
Just Ken and Zach.
Sounds good.
All right, Nick?
Predictions.
I got nothing. I said what I had to say.
Nick's got nothing.
That we're
gonna try
not
going to
win a championship
for
a while.
My prediction is Ortiz will retire.
No.
He'll actually retire.
He'll do what Pedro does and just keep coming back at spring training and just help people.
I'd like him. He's got a good bat right now. But anyways, this has been Sports Scholars. This is my team. This was a lot of knowledge to take in, and have a nice day.